The passage in your Bible is 2 Kings chapter 1. We're going to start in before that in 1 Kings 21, but just get in that neck of the woods and you'll be in the right spot. As we finish our series on Elijah today, and if you remember back at the beginning, I entitled the first message and the entire series, Faithfulness in Toxic Times. And we have we left our hero last week, or saw him last week, depressed, burned out, and quitting. Many of you weren't here. It wasn't a good day to get into church last week, but so that's what you missed. He was depressed, he was burned out, he was ready to quit, but God restored him, first of all with just physical recovery, gave him some food and some rest, and then brought him to himself on Mount Sinai and showed him a little more of God than he really understood. God showing a wind, an earthquake, and then a fire, and he was not in any of those, but then God was in the voice of silence, showing Elijah that God does not always work through the spectacular or supernatural. In fact, when it seems like God is not there at all, sometimes he is working even most powerfully, a lesson that Elijah needed to learn. And then he gently put him back to work. He sent him out on another job, but not like the others. He wasn't going to be fighting 450 prophets of Baal anymore, at least at this time. His job, as it's stated in the passage we looked at last week, was to anoint a couple of kings, which weren't even going to be around until after he was gone. So that was symbolic, showing him that God was now working mightily, not through prophets in the spectacular, but through the natural course of political leaders. In fact, the two kings he told him to anoint, which means they were going to be God's anointed, were the king of an enemy nation and an ungodly king of Israel that was no better than the previous or present rulers that they had. So, by the way, a lesson for us, you know, is God working when we don't think the right people are in office, or when we see other nations that are, in the sense of our enemies, seeming to succeed? Don't think God's not working. Those might be his anointed for what he has in mind in the course of human history. And so he gently puts him back to work. The one thing he did have him do that was significant was to take on an assistant, Elisha, and begin training him to take over for him. So it's really interesting when you see what God did for the depressed, burned out, and quitting Elisha. There's some things to learn for us. If we're ever in that state, and by the way, in toxic times, it's easy to get there, where we're depressed, we're burned out, we're done. Look at what God did. First of all, take care of yourself physically. Get rest, eat right, get healthy. Second, go to God. Go back to him. Find your source of inspiration there. And thirdly, get back to work, but don't do as much as you were doing before. Ease back into it, but get going again. Good advice for anyone who's fighting that kind of depression, that burnout, that idea they want to quit. And that's what we looked at last week. And Elijah, as we do go on in the text, does find Elisha, and he becomes his right-hand man, going along with him as he continues on. And God was not done with Elijah yet. He wasn't going to be doing the fantastic things like Mount Carmel with the fire from heaven, although we are going to see fire from heaven this morning as we look at the text, but not quite in the same way. But he has him in a ministry of speaking the truth in those toxic times. And as we look at our world today, I think it's pretty obvious. Our world in general does not believe the Bible as the truth. Our world today generally does not believe that Jesus is the truth, although he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And the world that we live in today, in many ways, is quite toxic for those of faith. So these things do apply to us, and I think when we see the ministry of speaking the truth, this is something that we can all take to heart as we live out our lives, our faithfulness in these toxic times. He called him to speak the truth. First of all, to identify that which is wrong. As we go on through 1 Kings, and we're skipping some of these chapters because they don't deal with Elijah, who we are focusing on, but Ahab and Jezebel continue in their wicked ways, although God protects Elijah. If you remember, Jezebel vowed that he was going to be dead before 24 hours were up. Well, that didn't happen. And in fact, as time goes on, he is protected. He's still around. They never do get rid of him. But we come to chapter 21, And there's a man named Naboth. Naboth had a very, very nice vineyard, and it happened to be right next to Ahab's palace. Now, poor Ahab had to go somewhere else to get his vegetables. He had to bring them in from somewhere else. And this little piece of land that Naboth had would have been a perfect vegetable garden for him. So Ahab goes to Naboth, and by the way, not wrongly, he kind of does this in the right way, and says, I'll tell you what, if you give me this, I will give you a better one somewhere else. He was probably going to give him his other vegetable garden, which was a ways away, which he didn't like. He said, if not, I'll give you money for it. However, Naboth was a family man, and he recognized this was the inheritance of his forefathers. This was an inheritance as an Israelite, and he took that to heart, and there were heartstrings attached. This was his family farm, and he said, no, I can't do that. I can't give up what's been in my family from the beginning here. Since we entered the promised land, this has been my family's plot. No, sorry, cannot do that. So Ahab, who had a tendency to be a rather big baby, reacts in this way. If you look at chapter 21 and verse 4, you'll see his response. So Ahab came into his house sullen and vexed because of the word of Naboth the Jezreelite had spoken to him. And he said, for he said to him, I will not give you the inheritance of my fathers. He lay down on his bed and turned away his face and ate no food. Boy, what a major league pout going on by Ahab. Now Jezebel, and you know Jezebel by now if you've been following along, she came and saw that and said, what are you doing, you sap? You are the king of Israel. Get up and eat food and go have a party. I'll see to it that you get this land. And you know how Jezebel was. So what they did was, if you read on this passage, they called a fast, they called a solemn assembly, not a celebration, but a mourning time. Something significantly bad had happened is what that means. And they put Naboth, this is all in Jezebel's instructions here, they put Naboth in the seat of dishonor and had two false witnesses stand up and proclaim that he cursed both God and the king, which was grounds for stoning, and had him publicly stoned. Then she said to Ahab, okay, he's dead, go take possession of the land. It's nobody's now, you're the king, it's yours. And Ahab did this. And this is where we get our next call of God to Elijah. For he calls him to speak. Look at verse 17 of chapter 21. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down to meet Ahab, the king of Israel, who is in Samaria. Behold, he is in the vineyard of Naboth, where he has gone down to take possession of it. And you shall speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord, you have murdered and taken possession. And you shall speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord, in the place where the dogs licked up the blood of Naboth, the dogs will lick up your blood, even yours. He gives him a ministry of speaking the truth in identifying wrong. Now, nobody else knew this was wrong. All everyone knew was Naboth really blew it. He did something that was grounds for stoning, and they publicly took care of him. But Elijah identified the truth, that no, this was wrong. This was murder. This was stealing. And he called forth the truth. In toxic times, sometimes we, the people of God, are called to speak the truth, to identify the wrongs around us. Because in toxic times, sometimes wrong becomes right in the public's eyes. And sometimes that which is wrong is accepted, and sometimes it's not even seen. One of the callings of the people of God during toxic times is to speak the truth into that, to identify that which is wrong. That's why I think we as the church keep speaking out against things like abortion, even though much of the public thinks that's just fine. What's wrong is wrong. And at those times, we do need to speak out. Now, by the way, this will not win you any popularity contests. In fact, take notice of how Ahab addresses Elijah in verse 20. Ahab said to Elijah, have you found me, O my enemy? This is what speaking the truth will get you many times. Some will consider you the enemy. By the way, he was answered by Elijah, I have found you because you have sold yourself to do evil in the sight of the Lord. So we are called as God's people in toxic times to speak truth against the wrongs that are out there. But then he goes a little further. And sometimes we are called to speak the truth in proclaiming God's judgment. Now, let me give you a little caveat here. I want to be very careful in saying this and want you to be very careful in hearing it. When I say sometimes we are called to speak the truth in preaching and proclaiming God's judgment, we need to be very, very wary that we are not speaking our own personal judgment, our own personal wishes. Make sure it is of God and it is clearly a judgment that God has proclaimed against something. Because it's very easy to start proclaiming judgment because we don't like something and we think God should do something. We are not the one that gets to make those calls. We have to always understand that. That's a way above our pay grade to pronounce judgment on someone. Now, when God pronounces judgment, sometimes we are called to be the spokespersons for that. And in this case, Elijah definitely was. Look at beginning of verse 21. He says to Ahab, "Behold, I will bring evil upon you and will utterly sweep you away and will cut off from Ahab every male, both bond and free in Israel, and I will make your house like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, like the house of Baasha, the son of Eliah." Those are previous bad kings, by the way. "Because of the provocation which you have provoked me to anger and because you have made Israel sin, of Jezebel, who also has the Lord spoken, saying, 'Dogs will eat Jezebel in the district of Jezreel.' The one belonging to Ahab who dies in the city, the dogs will eat. The one who dies in the field, the birds of the heaven will eat. And surely there is no one like Ahab who sold himself to do evil in the sight of the Lord because Jezebel, his wife, incited him. He acted very abominably in following the idols according to all that the Amorites have done, whom the Lord cast out before the sons of Israel." Wow. That's quite a judgment. When he talks about the dogs eating and the birds eating, that means they will not even get a proper burial. Again, not popular. But he was called clearly by God to say these things. I want to be careful because I'm not saying we are called to go out and start pronouncing judgment on everything. But when it is very clear and it's very appropriate, and those are the times you only know when you're close with God. Sometimes it is time, in toxic times, to speak out what God's judgment is. Not only because it gives us some kind of a sense of, gee, that's vengeance, we're speaking the truth, but it's really a call to repentance. And that is what we're here for, isn't it? As the Church of Jesus Christ, if we are doing the work of Jesus, we are to be a part of calling people to repentance. And by the way, very interesting here, look at how Ahab responds to this. Verse 27, "It came about when Ahab heard these words that he tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and fasted, and he lay in sackcloth and went about despondently." He repented, in a sense. "Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, 'Do you see how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself before me, I will not bring the evil in his days, but I will bring the evil upon his house in his son's days.'" Ahab, because he responded to this not arrogantly, not saying, okay, time to kill Elijah, although he'd already tried that several times and that didn't work. But he humbled himself genuinely before the Lord. And because of that, God always responds to repentance. Do you know that? The most evil people in the world, if they repent, God will respond. Now, this was not a full repentance unto salvation. Ahab has a long career of avoiding that. He had all kinds of opportunity on Carmel for that. When he himself was agreeing that Yahweh is king, but then when he came back to Jezebel, that kind of fizzled out. But God responded and said, because of this, you will not see the judgments in your lifetime, but they will still be there on his sons. Very interesting. How God responds in that way. But sometimes we are called to speak the truth in proclaiming God's judgment because it may very well be what's needed to bring about repentance. And that is the ultimate goal. But then as we move on, let's go to 2 Kings chapter 1. We're skipping some of these chapters because they don't deal with Elijah, and that is who we're dealing with. But then we come to 2 Kings chapter 1, and Elijah is again called. Here's the situation, beginning with verse 1. "Now Moab rebelled against Israel after the death of Ahab. And Ahaziah, who was Ahab's son, who became king, Ahaziah fell through the lattice in his upper chamber, which is in Samaria, and became ill." We don't know anything more about this than what's said in that sentence. He fell through a lattice, he was injured, and then it says he became ill, most likely an infection, some kind of injuries that became infected and became very serious. So he sent messengers and said to them, go inquire of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron, whether I will recover from this sickness. Now, this once again shows you the state of Israel. This is Israel. These are the children of Jacob, whom God brought through the wilderness into the promised land. This is how far they have fallen. Not only was Ahab, his father, trying to get the Baals to be the gods of Israel, now when he gets sick and needs to inquire or wants to find out what's going to happen, he goes to Baal-zebub of Ekron. By the way, Baal-zebub means god of the flies. He is later on a name that is taken up in the New Testament as a general name for Satan. But this is the first time we see it in Scripture. So he sends messengers to go to Ekron to inquire of Baal-zebub as to whether he would live or not, the extent to which they have fallen. And here we see Elijah once again called by God. Verse 3, but an angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, arise and go up and meet the messengers of the king of Samaria and say to them, it is because there is no God in Israel that you're going to inquire of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron? Here he was called to speak truth when God was being dishonored. This was as much of a slap in the face to Yahweh as you could do. The king of Israel saying, I need to find out something, so I'm going to Ekron, to the Lord of the Flies, to see what's going to happen. So God calls Elijah to speak the truth. And by the way, a third time we are called to speak the truth in toxic times is when God is being dishonored. That's time for us to speak up and defend our God. So he does this. He sends out messengers, and Elijah comes and intercepts him and said, is it that there's no God in Israel that you need to go to Ekron, to Baal-zebub, to inquire them? Verse 5, when the messengers returned to him, he said to them, why have you returned? They said to him, a man came up to meet us and said to us, go and return to the king who sent you and say to him, thus says the Lord, is because there is no God of Israel that you're sending to inquire of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron, therefore you shall not come down from the bed where you have gone up. You will surely die. That was the message of Elijah from God. He said to him, what kind of a man, who is it that came up to meet you and spoke these words? I love this verse, these next couple. He answered, it was a hairy man with a leather girdle bound around his loins. And he said, Elijah the Tishbite. By the way, a hairy man doesn't necessarily mean he had a lot of hair. He wore a hairy cloak, a hair garment. But he heard that discovery, and I love that, Elijah the Tishbite. Going to my Seinfeld there with Newman again on that one. By the way, this will not make you popular, defending God when he is dishonored in toxic times. And so the king, verse 9, sent to Elijah, a captain of 50 with his 50, and went up to him, and behold, he was sitting on top of the hill. By the way, this might be Mount Carmel. We're not sure. And he said to him, O man of God, the king says, come down. He sent an entire group of 50 soldiers. He sent out to kill them. He wasn't going to bring him back. He was going to have him executed. He knew he's a man of God. He knew he had power. He figured 50 soldiers should be able to take care of whatever he does. So they find him and say, O man of God, no doubt mockingly, come down. The king says, come down. Now, I told you you'd get some fire from heaven on this one, didn't I? Verse 10, Elijah replied to the captain of 50, if I am a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50. Then fire came down from heaven and consumed him and his 50. So the king again sent him another captain of 50 with his 50. Sent another 50. Said, O man of God, no doubt mockingly again, thus says the king, come down quickly. Come down now. Quit messing around. Elijah does the same thing. Verse 12, if I'm a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50. And the fire of God came down from heaven and consumed his 50. So there's 100 soldiers gone. So King Ahaziah sends another 50. Not the sharpest knife in the drawer, that Ahaziah. But fortunately, the captain this time was a little sharper. As we look at verse 13, when the captain of the 50 came up, he came and bowed down on his knees before Elijah and begged him and said to him, O man of God, this time no doubt not mockingly, please let my life and the lives of these 50 servants of yours be precious in your sight. Behold, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the first two captains of 50 in their 50s, but now let my life be precious in your sight. And the angel of the Lord said to Elijah, go down with him. Do not be afraid. You're safe now. They're not going to kill you this time. So he arose and went down with him to the king, and then he said to the king, thus says the Lord, because you have sent messengers to inquire of Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron, it is because there is no god in Israel to inquire of his word. Therefore, you shall not come down from the bed where you've gone up. You shall surely die. And it ends in verse 17. So Ahaziah died according to the word of the Lord, as Elijah had spoken. And because he had no son, Jehoram became king in his place in the second year of Jehoram, the son of Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah. Sometimes we are called to speak the truth when God is dishonored. It is never popular, but that's what God desires. Speaking the truth is what Elijah was called to at this point. We are not going to go any further with the life of Elijah. We could go on and we could look at his leaving, if you read ahead, and please do. Next chapter, he goes in a unique way. He is one of the very, very few people in the history of mankind that did not die. He was taken up into heaven. We have basically him and Enoch and those who are alive at the rapture taken up. A flaming chariot came down and picked him up, and Elisha witnessed it. And we're not covering that passage because that passage is really more about Elisha than Elijah. We could go into the New Testament and look at Elijah. He was considered the premier classic Old Testament prophet, right down to the way he dressed. John the Baptist was one like him. When they saw John the Baptist, they said, oh, he's a prophet like the old, thinking of Elijah. And in fact, Jesus said he was Elijah, not in the flesh, but in the spirit. He was there in the same power and for the same purpose of Elijah that came to call people back to repentance in preparation for the Messiah who was about to emerge on the scene. And so there's much more to be said about Elijah, but we are ending our study there because that's basically all that is talked about in his ministry. It's interesting, if you want to keep on reading, Elisha has a very interesting prophetic career as he received a double portion of the spirit of Elijah. But what we want to say in conclusion here is in toxic times, we who are the people of the truth are sometimes called to proclaim that truth. When there is wrongs, we are called to identify them. Sometimes we are called to proclaim judgment, bring people to repentance. Sometimes we're called to proclaim the truth when we are defending, when God is just being blatantly dishonored. We're called to speak up at those times. It will not make us popular, but God will protect us. And it needs to be done in times like those, and Elijah's a great example of that. What have we learned in this series? If you've been here for the entire series on faithfulness in toxic times, we've learned that in toxic times, we need to trust God. Do not fear. Trust God. He is in charge. Things are not beyond his control, and things are not beyond what he is called to happen. We can trust him. He will take care of us. He provided for Elijah with ravens in the wilderness bringing him food and jars of oil and flour that would not run down. He will provide for us as well. In toxic times, we are called to have courage, for God is indeed with us. We don't need to live in fear as God's people. In toxic times, we are called to believe in the impossible. Don't think there's anything God can't do. Don't underestimate what he can and will do in and through us. In toxic times, sometimes we're called to just wait. Just wait it out and have patience, because it will seem like a long time is passing, sometimes with nothing happening, even though we think it should be happening. And we need to keep faithful and keep seeking God and keep trusting him in those times. In toxic times, we need to get back on the horse when we fall off or are knocked off. Because sometimes that will happen, and we'll be ready to quit the whole thing. We remember what God did at that point with Elijah. Take care of yourself physically. Return to the Lord. Ease yourself back into his ministry, but get back into it. Get back into service. And we need to always be ready to speak the truth when it needs to be spoken, because in toxic times, we may be the only ones speaking the truth. And the truth indeed is what sets people free, and it is the hope of mankind. So this is what we've looked at in the life of Elijah. Remember, he was a nobody from nowhere, just like us. Do not underestimate what God can do in and through you by the power of his Spirit. It may not be spectacular like Elijah. In fact, it most likely won't be. But as we learned at on Mount Sinai with Elijah, as he was meeting with God, it wasn't the fantastic that God showed in his coming. It was the voice of silence. Yet it was powerful to be life-changing. So whoever you are, wherever God has you, don't think you're unimportant. You can be just a little Elijah wherever you are, being faithful in toxic times, being a bearer of the truth, a bearer of hope, a bearer of the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the hope of mankind. Let's pray.